Good afternoon. We start with breaking news on a police shooting in Sydney's west. Officers opening fire on two men in an allegedly stolen car in Wentworthville. Police will allege the driver drove at them.
The officers immediately rendered first aid until the arrival of the New South Wales ambulance paramedics. The males were taken to Westmead Hospital, where one is reported to be in a critical condition and the second in a serious but stable condition.
The car was allegedly stolen from the home of Penrith MP Karen McEwen, and we will have more on this breaking story coming up at 4:30. Police are on the hunt for two suspects linked to an alleged stabbing murder in Guildford earlier this year, releasing fresh CCTV after charging two men. The two 23-year-olds are accused of stabbing 37-year-old Jasesi McGoon in the chest, who later died in hospital.
One of the theories is this was a targeted attack on Jasesi McGoon, and possibly one of the motives, one of the theories of the investigation would be that it was drug-related.
And reporter Massilia Eiley will have more details coming up later in the bulletin. Israel has launched new attacks on the West Bank and Lebanon, causing many fatalities as it hunts down its enemies in Hezbollah and Hamas. The World Health Organization expressing concerns that desperately needed health workers are among the latest casualties. This report from Europe correspondent Edward Godfrey in Tel Aviv.
There's been a deadly airstrike in the West Bank. At least 14 people killed in the city of Tulkarm, according to the Palestinian Health Ministry. Local media here in Israel had been reporting that the IDF conducted an airstrike earlier. Details on that are still developing. Meanwhile, fighting and airstrikes are continuing in Lebanon, and they are persisting in central and southern Beirut. There have been multiple blasts. The Lebanese Health Ministry says 9 people have been killed in one. Ground fighting is continuing over the border in southern Lebanon too, with Israeli troops clashing with Hezbollah. And for the first time, the Lebanese army has fired back at Israel after one of its soldiers was killed. More residents have also been warned to evacuate their homes in southern communities. The IDF says Hezbollah has fired up to 230 projectiles into Israel in the last 24 hours. That's the most since the ground incursion began. They've been aimed at Haifa and in the north. There are claims too that many health workers have been killed in the conflict in Lebanon in the last couple of days, prompting these remarks from the World Health Organization Director General.
In Lebanon alone, 28 health workers have been killed in the last 24 hours. Many health workers are not reporting to duty as they fled the areas where they work due to bombardments.
Iran has shared a video spruiking its firepower, claiming to show the missile barrage launch a couple of nights ago. 180 ballistic missiles fired into Israel, many not intercepted by the Iron Dome.
Well, Israel is remaining silent as it plans a response to Iran following this week's missile attacks. The US president was quizzed about whether the target could be oil facilities, his response causing an immediate surge in prices. More from US correspondent Jonathan Kersley.
From here at the White House, US President Joe Biden offered some sort of insight into what Israel might do as retaliation for the missiles launched by Iran. Israel's Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu met with his top security officials once again as he tries to work out what course of action he takes. The United States and Israel are in talks about Israel's next step. Yesterday, President Biden said he would not support strikes by Israel on Iran's nuclear facilities. Today, asked about strikes targeting the oil sector, this was his response.
Do you support striking Iran's oil facilities, sir?
We're in discussion of that. I think that would be a little... Anyway.
Following those comments, the US oil price again surged, and Iran has said any strikes on its oil and gas industry would be a red line that would have been crossed. A former Israeli prime minister has said Israel should be going after Iran's nuclear facilities, but that would be a significant escalation too. An Israeli response is not a matter of if, but when. As for that timing, well, officials in Israel are saying that could be within a matter of days.
Two Australian jets are preparing to evacuate hundreds of citizens in Lebanon as Israel's attacks intensify. Live to Claudia Radoljak, our federal politics reporter in Canberra. Claudia, good afternoon. Can you bring us up to date with the government's plans?
Good afternoon, Sophie. Well, as you mentioned, two more flights leave tomorrow, but with the capital under attack, authorities are warning it's possible Beirut Airport could close, and they're pleading with Australian residents in Lebanon to take commercial flights now if they can. Some citizens managed to get out last night, helped by Australian officials at Beirut Airport and on board planes arranged by Canada. But only 41 of the 80 tickets secured were actually taken up. The Australian government is confident it will fill all 500 seats reserved on two more flights taking off tomorrow, chartered from a Brisbane company. Those jets will land in Cyprus. Now, of the 15,000 Australians who are in Lebanon right now, only 2,338 have registered to leave with the Department of Foreign Affairs. That number growing from 1,700 yesterday. But still, the federal government is reiterating calls for those who aren't planning to evacuate to listen to the warning and leave.
We have been warning for many months now, pleading with people to please leave Lebanon because it is not a safe place. If people can leave by commercial means, they should take up the opportunities as soon as possible.
If people are waiting for a RAF flight, that is going to get more and more difficult. So I would just say that they should heed the advice of the Prime Minister, book that commercial flight now and get out of harm's way.
Opposition leader Peter Dutton has also been calling for the Iranian ambassador to Australia to be expelled over a social media post where he praised slain Hezbollah leader Hassan Nasrallah. Prime Minister Anthony Albanese condemning those comments, but he wouldn't go as far as expelling him, pointing to the importance of maintaining a diplomatic relationship with Iran. Sophie.
Claudia, thank you. Well, Sydney police say there will be significant resources in the CBD this weekend for an approved pro-Palestinian rally. Police reached a last-minute agreement over Sunday's rally after an early attempt to block it. A static vigil is planned for Monday, the one-year anniversary of the Hamas attack on Israel.
Their undertaking is that it will be a peaceful small vigil. As Mr. McKenna has said, though, we can't rule out, and we would always be concerned, that there'd be interlopers. People will come in for the wrong reason.
We will be going ahead with a vigil at Town Hall, a candlelight vigil to mourn the loss of over 42,000 Palestinians and over 1,000 Lebanese people in this war, and to give members of our community an opportunity to mourn and to reflect on the past year.
Meantime, Australian Federal Police have issued a statement with state and territory police pleading for peaceful rallies planned across the country.